Yes. Hi. I'd like to wish you a warm welcome here tonight at the Balie. My name is Sarah Sluimer. We have a very special program for you. I will start by telling you how we came up with this particular night. Last week, I mean the guy that's sitting over there, Willem Bos, he organized a fundraiser with the fund, maybe you've heard about it, She Decides, because of the global gag rule, President Donald Trump took away $500 million to women in areas where they need social health control, where they need to have, a good, I have to get used to the English, poor women that need to have good social health control, who need proper abortions, who need things they can protect themselves with, like condoms. He took that away, and so we decided to raise some money to help them get that money back. That is where it started. So we had a big night, and we had people who spoke, we had people who performed, and we asked Sarah Kendzior to be with us that night, but she couldn't, and I think that's for the best, because she could come here a week later, so now we have her for a whole evening to ourselves. So I think we should be really happy with that. Tonight's evening is going to be as follows. First, Sarah is going to give us a keynote speech, and then we have a panel consisting of three people, and I will introduce them to you later. But before I ask Sarah, who is, and everybody knows here who Sarah is, but for the ones that don't know, she is a great journalist. Over the course of 1 year, actually, she went from Cassandra to prophet. Do you guys know who Cassandra is? She's like from the old Greek century, the woman who always told what was going to happen and nobody believed her. Well, that was Sarah. She told us in detail what was going to happen if Trump would be chosen as president and what would happen the upcoming 4 years. And now everybody believes her, and she writes for The Correspondent, which is a Dutch platform. She writes for The Guardian, Politico, The New York Times. Well, you write for everything in some way. Okay, we're going to start with her keynote speech. But first, we're going to watch a short clip. Marietje Schaake, who is a member of the European Parliament, has some kind of inspirational message for us. So let's just watch that.
Good evening. My name is Marietje Schaake. I'm a member of the European Parliament with the Progressive Liberal Party, D66. And I really wish I could have joined you for a discussion on the essence of what is at stake today, the open society. I would have particularly liked to hear from Sarah Kendzior in person, because I read and value her excellent journalistic work, which paints a very bleak picture of what is happening and what is ahead. When I began serving here as a member of European Parliament 7.5 years ago, the world seemed a different place. We were mainly able to focus on how to realize more rights and freedoms for more people, and thought that progress and democracy could go viral. But when massive popular protests erupted in North Africa and the Middle East, European leaders did not offer the adequate response. Instead, focus shifted to working with authoritarian regimes on stability, anti-terror measures, and now also on so-called migration management. Human rights and international law are compromised so remarkably fast, or they are traded away. This in turn erodes our credibility on the global stage and our ability to set a normative standard. I do see that open societies are threatened by real external threats, but also risk being eroded from within. Add to that the growth of a cooperation between nationalists to undermine the European Union and the open society and liberal democracies. In these uncertain times, blame games are popular. The many attackers of the status quo are answered by only very few defenders of fundamental principles. Now, I do not believe we should not criticize and improve, reform and innovate policies and our very political system, for example. But I also am convinced that we should not think lightly of attacks on the foundations of our open society. In both the US and here in Europe, politicians attacking judges and journalists, as well as identifying entire groups in the population as scapegoats, is a recipe for disaster. Still, many people believe President Trump will automatically calm down. Others are disengaging because the news completely depresses them. But I believe we must not be bystanders and strengthen the core of liberal democracies. This also means better prioritizing and organizing among a highly diverse set of people and political actors. So I hope your discussion tonight will not only contribute to a very precise analysis of the problems we face, but can also contribute to empowering and mobilizing anyone who wants to push back against the attacks on open societies, to push back against the erosion of the rule of law from within.
Okay. Sarah, can we have a big round of applause for Sarah Kendzior? You can sit up.
This is working?
No, it's not on.
Oh, yeah. Now it's on. Okay, great. Thank you. I mean, this is kind of a, you know, nightmarish thing, Sarah Kendzior and President Trump and the authoritarian state. If you had told me a few years ago I would be highlighting a panel that's called that, I probably would have fled in horror. That said, it's a pleasure to be here. Thank you very much to the organizers of this conference, and especially to my colleagues at De Correspondent for arranging this panel, giving me a platform at a time when my own government has labeled me and other journalists as the opposition party and as the enemy of the people. It's nice for the enemy of the people to have a home abroad. That said, as a newly established enemy of the people, I was advised to not bring my laptop and technology through airport security, so my keynote is written in a notebook, like a fourth grade book report, so please indulge me as I struggle not only with authoritarianism, but my own handwriting. I shall begin. Because I've predicted Trump's rise to power, you know, far in advance, as Sarah noted, I've become, as one place called me, the Cassandra of Trump land, which is not a fun thing to be, by the way. I would have much rather been completely wrong and, you know, had a mockery made of me and had world peace in the process. So if that trade comes around, I'll be happy to make it. But because of this, I've given a lot of talks, especially over the last month. And I've basically stopped preparing my talks too far in advance because every day has brought a series of unprecedented crises. I never know if during the time right before my talk, whether the Trump administration will have, for example, fabricated new terror attacks, whether the massacre in Bowling Green, Kentucky, or apparently there was great unrest in Sweden last night, or whether he will have caused an actual humanitarian catastrophe, like stripping away US healthcare, rounding up immigrants and Muslims and threatening their civil liberties on baseless grounds, defunding our schools, drilling our national parks and forcing a rogue National Park Service to be created, bringing white supremacists into the White House as new hires, engaging in various kleptocratic practices with a number of players, especially Russia, but you know other potential people involved, and you know, those are just a few of the lowlights. If I were to name them all, you would be here all night, perhaps for weeks. As the cesspool of racism, corruption, nepotism, and utter disregard for our constitutional rights and liberties has been devouring my country. So, if you know, during the time I started this presentation, Trump nuked North Korea or something, I guess we'll take it during the Q&A. So, tomorrow marks 1 month since Trump was inaugurated. It's a month that has felt like a decade, not only because of actual policy changes, but because of the psychological shift that has taken place among Americans. For until this month, Trump was viewed with profound denial. American optimism blinded many to the vulnerabilities of the US to authoritarian rule. The motto of authoritarianism is famously, it can't happen here. And the modern corollary to that this election season is, Trump can't win. You heard this over and over again. We heard it during the primary, despite ample evidence that he could win, including a weak Republican slate, manipulation of the mass media, which had him round the clock on American TV with many of his falsehoods uncontested, with his rallies aired nonstop, and his history of bullying and threats in order to control both media and political adversaries. We heard again he couldn't win in the general, even though once more there is evidence that things were in play. There was WikiLeaks selectively leaking documents on the Democratic Party, the meddling of Russia, and most of all, at this point, the mainstreaming of extremism, in which the fringes of political rhetoric and political policy were really pulled to the center. This was around the time when the masterful and cruel propagandist Steve Bannon was hired, and the media refused to investigate both his role and as well as Trump's history of corruption, as well as things like Russian meddling that could have predicted the outcome, sort of gliding along on the assumption that Hillary Clinton would win despite her own baggage and a contentious Democratic primary. All were part of willful blindness to our vulnerability to autocracy. And then he won. And then, of course, once he won, it was, okay, all right, he won, but we have checks and balances. We have the Constitution. We have people within our administration who aren't going to let him follow through on his anti-constitutional policies. This did not hold up. You know, what Americans, I think, have learned the hard way over the last month is that the Constitution is a piece of paper unless it's upheld. Checks and balances erode unless people are willing to stand by them. And that means contesting a very powerful and very corrupt administration. And you have seen some, you know, pushback, which is great, in which I'll get to that later. Meanwhile, Trump has been building a cabinet that seems designed to dismantle the very institutions that it's supposed to uphold. And so what is the lesson here? Along with people saying that Trump would win, there is also this hope that Trump would, quote, start acting presidential, also known as the pivot. Everyone kept saying for a year that eventually Trump would pivot, that he would change, despite his 70 years of fairly continuous aggressive behavior. Trump did not pivot. Trump pivoted America to him. The goal of his campaign was to redefine norms so that later it would be easier to redefine laws. And that is what he is attempting to do right now. And so what are some of these norms that the Trump administration wants us to believe are the new American normal? First, there's white supremacy as a dominant policy platform, seen most recently in the Muslim ban and anti-Muslim rhetoric. Kleptocracy based around Trump's family and this idea that the president is somehow above the law instead of representative of the law and bound to uphold the law. Suppression of free speech by the public and the mainstreaming of hate speech as a sort of anti-political correct attitude and telling it like it is. Even though there's been physical consequences for those speech, there's been, you know, bomb threats and beatings, especially in the months leading up to election night and in the weeks after. And so along with this, we also have an era in which there is very little transparency for government beyond the leaks that Trump so vehemently opposes, while there's total transparency of citizens who are subject to slander, to doxing, and to harassment from above. And this is something that unfortunately I think may continue more so as the months go on if the protests against him continue. There's also been a reconception of the idea of the government as providing public services. This idea seems to have been thrown out the window, with tax dollars instead going to pay for things like Melania Trump to live in a golden tower or a giant vanity wall put up against Mexico. And so now these are no longer hypothetical campaign promises. They are policies that are affecting our real life. And in some cases, they are not new. They are part of a long history of abusive power and systemic racism in the United States, a system of exploitation that relies on the willingness of the public to be both complacent and cruel. The U.S. has always been a flawed democracy. The U.S. was founded on stolen land, built by slaves, had a history of denying voting rights to all but white men for most of its existence. Its persecuted immigrants put put ethnic groups in internment camps, used the judicial system to target Black and Hispanic citizens, ethnically profiled Muslims after 9/11, and that's just to name a few examples. So, you know, in a way, Trump is not novel, but kind of an ultimate culmination of a long arc of history that we often tend to ignore. We've always had politicians who flirted with making these precepts part of their platform, part of their identity, instead of cloaking them in the language of liberty or security. For example, in the era before the Civil War, the anti-immigrant, quote, know-nothing party, this is what they were actually called, was on the rise with a philosophy that was very similar to Trump's. And as an example of this, I want to read you a quote from Abraham Lincoln from 1855 that he wrote to his friend Joshua Speed. He wrote, "Our progress in degeneracy appears to be pretty rapid. As a nation, we begin by declaring all men are created equal. We now practically read it as all men are created equal except Negroes. When the know-nothings get control, it will read all men are created equal except Negroes and foreigners and Catholics. When it comes to this, I should prefer immigrating to some country where they make no pretense of loving liberty, to Russia, for instance, where despotism can be taken pure and without the base alloy of hypocrisy." So as you can see, unfortunately, that quote, which preceded the Civil War, holds up pretty well today. So as I was saying, in a sense, this is a continuation of the worst of U.S. politics, of systematic and structural abuses that better Americans, like Abraham Lincoln, have always opposed. But there still are some things that are distinct and new about the Trump administration, a level of danger which is truly unprecedented in its potential to unleash humanitarian consequences both in the U.S. and abroad. First, there's the matter of Donald Trump as an ostensible human being. Trump is basically like a magnet attracting the worst Americans. He's long posed as a success, but banked on his ability to pay off others to market him as he's failed. He likely owes a large amount of money to people both in the U.S. and abroad, which makes him vulnerable and seems to have no problem abusing executive power to build kleptocratic wealth. He's also temperamentally unstable, to put it mildly, and cruel, and surrounded by people whose motives often don't seem to be political in nature, but just cruelty for cruelty's sake, like Steve Bannon. And he's working in tandem with many around the world who find his ego malleable. Trump is part, you know, as I'm sure you know here, of a broader right-wing, often white supremacist movement that's been rising throughout Europe and bringing extremists together. On that note, the second sort of unusual thing about Trump's campaign is that white supremacy and even neo-Nazism, neo-fascism, has become the center of the platform, which is something that we haven't seen in U.S. history in a mainstream political candidate. Some of the voters I've talked to that voted for Trump were able to overlook this, but for others, this was Trump's primary appeal. And the Trump administration does not even really pretend to hide this. Their denials tend to be audacious lies meant to make citizens feel powerless, to feel as if there's no sense in speaking truth to power when power is the only truth. From what I gather, a similar phenomenon is happening here in the Netherlands. And I'll remark a bit on Geert Wilders, who has also embraced anti-Muslim and xenophobic rhetoric, sold under a guise of populism, but with cruelty at its core. In the end, such politicians and policies tend to hurt everyone, including those who voted for the extremist candidate. We've seen this play out in Russia, in Poland, in Hungary, and in the UK after Brexit. As the most vulnerable citizens, generally ethnic and racial minorities, suffer, promises to those who put faith in the white nationalist candidates also tend to be broken, with only the candidate and his small group of backers profiting in the end. Finally, there's the unique time in which we live, which was alluded to in the video before. I don't think Trump could have happened at another time. I think that Trump is a representative of the collapse of institutional norms and strength of institutions in the U.S. as much as he's caused them to further diminish in quality and strength. To go briefly over the last 15 years, we've had the recession of 2008, from which much of the U.S., especially where I live in the heart of the U.S., never truly recovered. We had two wars, which destabilized the entire Middle East, causing repercussions, for you in Europe, as well as us in the United States. And we've had the rise of social media, which I don't think that any government has managed to keep pace with, which I think, for all of the good that it's caused, has caused political chaos and has proved very ripe for manipulation by foreign actors. So, as we were saying, I tend to be a bleak speaker, so I'll try to go out with something a little more positive. So, you may be wondering, well, what can you do about this unprecedented autocratic disaster? And so here's some advice. My first tip is to keep expectations high. And so, what do I mean by that? I don't mean you should keep your expectations high in the sense that you think that they will actually be responded to by the government, that the government will serve you, which is its job, and that there'll be a satisfactory outcome. But you need to keep your expectations high in terms of, what you value, what you think is important, and what you expect others to do. You need to honor constitutional principles even if they don't, honor moral principles even if you don't, and refuse to let them change who you are and what you believe. Above all, stand up for others first. At times like this, the burden falls in an unprecedented way on citizens. And so unfortunately, it's up to citizens to be the representatives who failed them, to be the journalists who should have and didn't do a thorough investigation of these administrations, and to be the leaders who are not coming through for us. These kinds of regimes can take away everything from you materially, but they can't take your conscience, they can't change who you are inside. Secondly, you're not alone in this. This is a shared burden, as we've seen from the protests that have broken out worldwide. If we all do our part, we can prevent a sort of social change. We can prevent a sort of shift of norms to the kind of extremism that Trump and his administration are selling. And in the end, possibly affect political change. But I think the former is more important at this part. In the U.S. right now, there is massive resistance. There is greater civic resistance than I've ever seen in my entire life. And that's because most people don't want this. There's this false idea that Trump has a mandate, including in places where I live, that did vote for him overwhelmingly. But only about 25% of Americans did vote for him. Half of Americans didn't vote at all. I think we've learned that lesson the hard way. And of those who did vote for him, many of them that I've spoken to are deeply alarmed by the changes that are taking place, by the recklessness and the aggression of his administration. And so they find people resisting everywhere. You find lawyers coming as volunteers to the airports to help immigrants. You find teachers fighting to keep schools funded. You find politicians and protesters from all sides of the political spectrum working together, and ordinary citizens fighting back. And I do think, for all my pessimism, that there is strength in these numbers. There is strength in this type of resistance. We've never had an administration this threatening to democratic values, but we've also never had such a forceful response in return. Lastly, don't give up and don't give in. When you're met with a barrage of destructive policies put forth by men who might view you with contempt, it's very easy to become cynical or heartbroken or to feel like you have no choice but to accept this. There's a very American tendency to expect things to be okay, to want them to be okay, instead of to work for them to be okay for everyone. And so on that note, I have some advice from American traditions you may not be as familiar with. There's American intellectual tradition that never shared this blind optimism because the myth of the American dream was never designed to apply to them. This is the Black American intellectual tradition. And if you want to better understand both the U.S.'s history of white supremacy and earlier authoritarian policies on U.S. soil, I suggest reading Black American writers like James Baldwin, Langston Hughes, Frederick Douglass, who Donald Trump just discovered, Malcolm X, and Martin Luther King. And I'm going to close this presentation with a quote from Dr. King from a speech that he made 1 year before he was assassinated, as it expresses the urgency of the moment and the threat at hand and the clarity of what we need to do far better than I can. So this is a quote from him. "You may be 38 years old, as I happen to be, and one day some great opportunity stands before you and calls you to stand up for some great principle, some great issue, some great cause. And you refuse to do it because you are afraid. You refuse to do it because you want to live longer. You're afraid that you'll lose your job, or you're afraid that you'll be criticized and lose your popularity, or you're afraid that someone will stab you or shoot at you or bomb your house, so you refuse to take a stand. Well, you may go on and live until you're 90, but you're just as dead at 38 as you would be at 90. And the cessation of breathing in your life is but the belated announcement of an earlier death of the spirit." Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, I think I'd like to introduce the panel we have for tonight. First, we have Kirsten van den Heul. She's a publisher, or maybe she was a publisher, because right now she's running for parliament for the Socialist Party. Warm welcome to Kirsten. And then... Then we have Bertina Munaf. She's an expert in American politics. You can hear her a lot on Dutch radio. You can see her on Dutch television. And she worked with Anthony Weiner. And maybe we can ask something about that later on. But for now, warm welcome to Bertina. And last but not least, we have Robin de Wever. He's a freelance journalist. He's a freelance journalist. He also writes for The Correspondent, among other papers. And he specialized in religion, religious journalistic work. Yeah, and he wrote about Trump and the evangelicist. You did that. You wrote a few articles about the Christian society in America and how they relate to Trump. Okay, Robin de Wever. Thank you. I'm going to sit here as well, I think. Okay. At first, is this working? Yeah. At first, Sarah, I'd like to start with, because I think in some way that's important. If you're talking about your morals and how to keep them, and that's a thing that's going on in the Netherlands as well, have you lost many friends?
Have I?
Yeah.
No, I've had many strange conversations, but, I try to find common ground with people who I'm speaking to. I have relatives who, you know, were tempted to vote for Trump, who were Republicans, and I managed to talk them out of that, so they left the top box blank and just voted down ticket. But, no, I think my circles have widened in kind of ways that are unusual.
But, yeah. And in some way, has your life become political overall? Like, you wake up and you go to bed... always thinking about Trump.
Oh, yeah. No, yeah. I mean, unfortunately, a few months ago, I tweeted something like, I'm writing about Trump all the time in the hopes that in the next 4 years, I don't have to write about Trump at all. And unfortunately, that didn't work out well for me. But yeah, it's not just me as a journalist. I think every American, you know, kind of wakes up and thinks, oh, God, like, what did he do now? You know, because Trump has this tendency to tweet in the middle of the night. You know, and the fact that I'm even discussing this is ridiculous. Like, I shouldn't be worried that my, you know, president tweeted something antagonistic at a foreign power because he had insomnia or wasn't feeling well and we could potentially be at war by the time I rise. Like, that shouldn't be a normal concern. But, Americans are living in a high state of anxiety. There's a lot of chaos at this point. We're not quite sure, you know, how the administration is going to put these policies into practice. There's a lot of pushback from the public and from the judiciary. And it's led to a feeling of total instability where you just don't know what each day would bring and what new horror awaits us. Yeah. So that's obviously stressful.
And are there already people giving up? Because if you have this madness like day in, day out, then you can also be like, okay, I don't know how to relate to this anymore. I'm just going to live my life. Is that already happening? People getting used to the situation?
I mean, I think there's a difference between people that are just overwhelmed with events in their daily life, which I think is completely understandable. Like, you have to take care of your children, do your job. Not everybody is as engaged in politics. But I found very few people who don't feel kind of upended by everything that's going on. I find few people that have just bought into this as normal, including Trump voters. Some people voted for him with the expectation expectation of that there would be more stability. They felt like since the recession, stability was gone. They'd lost economic stability. They felt like society was changing too quickly, and they wanted Trump to kind of bring things back to what they thought of as normal. Instead, you know, they're very concerned. They're worried that we're going to go to war. They're worried that they are losing health insurance. They're, you know, looking at our airports full of protesters, looking at our streets full of protesters, and that makes them nervous. And one of the most interesting conversations I had was with a Trump voter who said to me, I wish the protests would stop, so I really hope that Trump changes his policies so that the protests would stop. And that's a very different attitude to hear from a conservative, because they usually just blame the protesters, like the protesters are evil and awful. But in this case, they blamed the administration. And I don't know if he's indicative of a broader trend, but I do feel like, above all, people want to just get back to, quote, normal. I mean, I don't know if we ever will. They want to just live their lives, and it's impossible when, you know, there's a new executive order every other day threatening to change the foundation of our country.
Can you guys, or we as a, yeah, can we ever get back to normal after this happened, even if he would be impeached in like half a year? Can we get back to normal, or is this just in what way, however, the beginning?
Yeah, I mean, one thing I should say is that normal wasn't good. I mean, the normal that we had before Trump was very, very flawed. You know, we were going through an economic crisis. We've had, you know, a whole history of racial tension, you know, and racial inequality that had come out in a lot of different ways. What we have now, though, is something new, which is, you know, I don't know how to quite describe it. I would not say the United States is an authoritarian state, but I would say our government is authoritarian in nature and would like it to be. And so we're having this kind of back and forth. And I think people would like to get back to, you know, the flawed America that at least felt familiar before. America feels unrecognizable now, and I think that that's deeply unsettling. But I do think if somehow we manage to do that, this should be a wake-up call for a lot of those pre-existing problems that were not, you know, well addressed, that lingered on for a long time. And I don't think we're sufficiently recognized, but I think that they are now, so.
Yeah. Okay, I have a question for all four of you. I'm going to start with you, Sarah, because you are the prophet, no, but a little bit. What do you think will happen over the course of the upcoming 4 years? And can you draw me the most positive and the most negative scenario?
Oh, God. It's hard for me to figure out at this point what's going to happen next week. My prophet abilities have diminished since he was inaugurated. I mean, the worst case scenario, you know, and I'm sorry to say this, is nuclear war, because Trump has been fascinated with nuclear weapons his entire life. Going back to the 80s, he once claimed that he learned everything that anyone needs to know about nuclear weapons within an hour. He has said, if we have them, why aren't we using them? He has said he wants to drop them on both Europe and the Middle East. And he's, you know, not a stable guy. And in the United States, the president can drop nuclear weapons without the permission of Congress or any other outside force. I think Steve Bannon is also keen on the idea. And that's very worrying. You know, I'm of the generation, I don't remember the Cold War that well. I've never lived with this fear of nuclear weapons before, and, you know, I'm very sorry for all those who did, because it's really scary. The best case scenario, you know, as an enemy of the state or whatever, I guess I could stay, I'd be kind of glad if the state, you know, is no longer there. You know, I do think that Trump has a history of corruption that is legally objectionable. It's just not it's not just a matter of I personally disagree with his policies. You know, I think we haven't seen his tax returns. He's engaged in a lot of nefarious activity with Russia and other foreign states. There's a possibility that he should not legally be in power. And if he is out of power, then I think some of the worst elements of his administration, people like Steve Bannon and, you know, Michael Flynn's already gone, so we're down. They may go with him. Then we're left with more of a typical Republican administration, which, you know, politically, I don't like that, but I think it's possible to combat it or to, you know, fight against it in ways that it's just not under Trump, who has no regard for law. I think as long as people have a regard for our constitution, for our democracy, if we disagree politically, you know, that's what democracy is about, is having different views. So the best case scenario would be that, you know, the most extremist elements get out and we work to resolve or improve the lives of people and work on those structural problems that have hurt Americans, you know, all over, you know, geographically, you know, racially, politically. It doesn't matter who you are. This has been a very rough, I guess, 9 years at this point since the recession, and I'd like to see that those sorts of things get improved.
Yeah. And Kirsten, how do you think we can get the, I don't know if this is, you can say it like this, but can we get the ghost back into the closet at this point?
No, I don't think so. If you were to ask me the worst case scenario, I mean, look at what's at stake at this point in Europe. We have elections in the Netherlands, in France, in Germany, and in the worst case scenario, populist parties in these countries would win the elections, and we would have a UN Security Council with a bunch of countries that are not necessarily advocates of rule of law and liberal democracies. I would say that the most optimist scenario, and I'm already seeing that, is, and we were talking about that right before we started, is that this unleashes something in a lot of people, let's say the silent majority that thought that everything would work out, and that same silent majority that often wonders if they even should go vote. Mm-hmm. And I see a lot of those people now waking up and saying, you know what, this is about me. And I see, for example, I'm a guest lecturer at The Hague University. I teach a course called Women in Society. It's a rather feminist course with a rather feminist lecturer. And it's a course that I teach in English. So I have many exchange students. And this semester, I have more American exchange students than ever. And during the first class, I always asked them, so what made you pick this course? And all of the Americans said, it was the U.S. elections that made me pick this course. And I want to explore my agency, and I want to explore what I can do to actually raise my hand. I want to join a political party. I want to stand up. And that gives me hope.
Yeah. So do you see that as well, Sarah?
Yeah.
Like the feminists get a kick in their butt. And they,
yeah, I mean, everyone kind of has. I've seen more civic engagement in the last month than I've seen in my life. And I definitely see the same trend among women. I know women who are planning to run for office or are currently running for office. Mm-hmm. I think there's definitely an attitude of, you know, we can't wait around for anybody to save us or help us. We have to be more aggressive. And I also see a lot of women, you know, getting backed up by other women, backed up by men. You know, our protests the day after the inauguration were called the women's protests. They were, you know, organized by women and primarily dominated by women, but, you know, men participated as well. And I think there's sort of, in reaction to the extreme misogyny of Trump, this idea of, you know, women are going to take charge of the situation. You know, a lot of the volunteer lawyers were women. The judges who are repealing the executive orders tend to be women. You know, all of that is very interesting to me because we're underrepresented. And I think that we'll see. We'll see how they rewrite laws, which is something autocrats do. But if we are able to run, I think you may see more women in American politics.
Yeah. And do you see that as well, Bettina? Or do you feel that, like you want to rise up against Trump as well? Or are you angry with how things are going right now? Or are you keeping
a distance? I don't really feel I'm in a position to rise up against Trump myself. But
why not?
Well, this is actually a question I also would like to ask Sarah, because for journalists, these are really interesting times.
Yeah.
And I also, I'm an editor for a current affairs show on Dutch Radio 1, and we're an opinion program, Radio Dit is de Dag.
Mm-hmm.
And we have to look for, we have to give a platform to all the opinions there are in society. And there are a lot of complaints about where are the Wilders voters? Where are the Trump voters? Why aren't you giving them a platform?
Yeah.
This is something we have to ask ourselves, how do we deal with that? And I don't know how it works where you come from, but in the Netherlands, we have different broadcasters and they all have their own identity. But we still have to have the appearance of neutrality.
Mm-hmm.
So I found it a struggle these past days. How do I deal with Trump? And I've been on talk shows during the primaries, and I heard myself saying, I don't want to think about a Trump presidency. Mm-hmm. So I was just assuming Hillary Clinton would end up being president. And I'm not sure whether that was right way to be a journalist, but I wonder, Sarah, how you look at yourself. Are you a journalist? Are you an activist? Are you both?
You know, I'm a journalist who abides by my constitution, you know, who believes in democracy. writing about an administration that doesn't. So in that sense, I think I become an activist involuntarily, as a lot of Americans are. I mean, I don't mind exactly being in that position. I feel like, you know, the role of journalism is to serve the public first and foremost, is to inform the public. That means informing the public of what this administration is doing. While this administration does not want transparency, does not want criticism, does not want to be examined, and I think, you know, well, too bad. Like, I'm going to do that anyway. And, you know, what will happen will happen. Like, I, you know, I don't know if you know this, but I got my PhD studying Uzbekistan, studying dissidents from Uzbekistan, you know, many of whom were also journalists and ended up in exile or had, you know, or who were jailed. You know, so I've seen people a lot braver than me, a lot more determined than me, manage to do this. So I don't feel like there's an excuse for me to back down.
And I think maybe you can be an activist and a journalist at the same time, or you're entitled to activism.
Yeah, I mean, I'm not going to feign objectivity in the sense of, you know, I'm going to say something positive about Trump for every, you know, negative thing I say. I'm going to just try to tell the truth. And, you know, I it's hard to come up with something positive other than he's a great propagandist. He's a great showman. He's a
Hair.
Yeah, yeah. His,
that's his not even true.
Impressive hair. he's an interesting individual. You know, I can be euphemistic, but, you know, I'm in a different position because I'm purposefully freelance, purposefully writing for foreign outlets in order to have that freedom of expression. Like, for more traditional outlets in the U.S., they wrestled with the same problems of, you know, we have to show both sides. But the mistake they made during the campaign season was that one side was pathologically lying, you know, which was pointed out.
And we have a hard time calling it a lie.
Yeah, I would say call it a lie. Like, give people a platform. I mean, everyone should be able to speak their mind. But if someone is just saying something that's factually untrue, like, the audience won't necessarily know that unless they're explicitly told, because I feel like the audacity of this kind of lying is new. I mean, politicians always bend the truth. That's not new at all. But the way, like, Trump will say something and then just the next day say he never said it, and they'll play a tape to him, and he basically is like, that's not me. I mean, it's like dealing with a three-year-old who spilled something on the floor, you know, and it's like right in front of you and they're lying. Like, that's his mentality. And so everyone is kind of struggling how to deal with it, and I think it would have been healthier if they had just called a lie right off the bat, you know?
Yeah, but the thing is, you have to be alert all the time, because I think everybody, know, when somebody tells you a lie and they tell it again and again a different lie, you get so tired.
Yes.
You know, you're just slipping into some kind of, you forget your anger or your. So how do you deal with that? Do you write it down every lie so you can remember every morning?
Yeah, I mean,
you said
I think
that.
I'm hardwired to call out the lies. Like, I don't know, that's just like my nature and I can't help myself. And the thing is it's not just me. I mean, there are a lot of, not just journalists, but regular citizens who go through all day because they're worried about the status of their country and about, you know, rising autocracy, and they track his lies and they call him out. And this is happening on a mass scale, and it's much more effective that way, I think, than if it's just journalists
Do you think it helps to change the minds of his voters?
It depends if those voters are reading the same material and content as others. Like, when I
Well, they're not reading the New York Times or the Washington Post, I think.
Sometimes they are. Sometimes they are, and then they think it's lies. You know, they agree with Trump. I mean, the one thing that sort of needs to be debunked is there's no monolith of Trump voters. There's like a huge, there's Trump fans are more of a monolith, but people who voted for him are just all over the map. Like, some of them didn't like Hillary Clinton. Some are, you know, anti-abortion rights. Some are just Republicans who always voted Republican and didn't think Trump would do the things he would do. So it's, you know, a whole mix of people. You know, as I said before, I live in a state that I think 65% of voters voted for Trump. So I talk to people who voted for Trump all the time, and I have managed to persuade some of them both before and after the election. You know, not on every issue, but we've had civil conversations. So I think it is possible. But then I think there's people who, as I said before, the worst things about him, you know, the racism, extremism, penchant for violence, is the attraction. And that's very hard to rid people of that kind of mindset. That's a mindset I can't quite engage with.
And Robin, did you see this coming? Because you wrote a lot about Trump voters.
Well, actually, yes, I did. Yeah, well, don't want to say I called it, but let's not. But we were just talking about the worst case scenario and the best case scenario, which made me think, if Trump gets impeached, does something horribly wrong and gets impeached tomorrow, it won't be over. And the entire climate that has brought forth Donald Trump and has set the conditions for him to flourish will still be there. Mm-hmm. Fox News will keep on defending him and set up some campaign comparable to the campaign that was fought against Obama for years, mm-hmm. Which was completely fact-free or mostly fact-free. American people have been inundated with that kind of thinking and the kind of fact-free thinking, and so I'm afraid that if he's gone tomorrow, if Steve Bannon is gone tomorrow, the legacy of Donald Trump and the legacy of the Republican Party that has made like strides to the right, far to the right, in the last, let's say, 10 years, 15 years, that will still be there.
Mm-hmm. Plus, we would still have Pence with a very clear track record on LGBTI, women's rights, civil rights.
Yeah, but we spoke about that as well. You think if Pence would be our next president, it wouldn't be this worse?
I mean, it wouldn't be as bad as Trump because of Trump's unique qualities, like his own financial corruption schemes, which have linked him into, you know, international kleptocracy arrangements with places like Russia, with foreign oligarchs, you know, his erratic temperament. There's certain things that are just unique to Trump as an individual, but yeah, the extremism of Mike Pence, who by the standards of the GOP is quite extreme, things he wanted to do in Indiana included having funerals for fetuses that were lost during miscarriages. He wanted to make that an actual policy. You know, he has a terrible record on women's rights, as you said, on LGBT rights.
Gerrymandering. So, the fact that gerrymandering is a thing. I don't know if it's... Gerrymandering is the redrawing of... what is the exact term?
Redrawing
of districts in a way that when elections are held, all the people who would vote for you are in your district, basically. Well, that is something completely unethical, I'd say.
Yeah, and it ensures a Republican domination of certain areas. Right. You know, it ensures that kind of platform.
And Republican voters don't even blink if they see gerrymandering happening around them.
Yeah, well, that's because the Republicans did it. The Democrats didn't.
Right. Yeah, yeah. But there's no uproar from Republicans or Democrats even. So
that's
the erosion of norms that has already taken place leading up to Trump.
But if you've entered the path of chaos and destruction, in some way we are doing that as well over here. Can you ever draw back from that? Because
it's hard. If I may add to what you were saying, I mean, I just read initial reports saying that the number of reported hate crimes since the election has risen over 1,000, and that's only the reported ones. So that's probably just the tip of the iceberg. So for people saying that, you know, it's just talk, and no, but those words actually lead to something. Mm. We've seen in the UK when Joe Cox was murdered that language can actually kill people or can actually inspire people to kill. And here in the Netherlands, we've had you know, pigs' heads thrown at mosques. Only yesterday, a mosque was actually there were slogans, extreme right-wing slogans sprayed on it. I mean, it does have an effect already, and it's very hard to
turn that around. Because that's I think the hardest thing right now.
Well, first of all, by making clear that everybody who feels part of that silent majority needs to go out and vote. I really cannot say that enough. People need to go out and vote. I mean, there's still so many people who are still hesitating whether it all makes sense. And, you know, to those people, I'd like to say, have a look at what happened in the United States of America. See what happened with the Brexit vote. So many young people didn't want the Brexit vote. They didn't go and vote. And see what happened.
Can I just add to that? Because it's really easy to criticize Trump and bash Trump, but the there's a reason for his success, and shouldn't we be talking about the root causes of his success? And I think that's also partially the lack of success of other mainstream political parties that left certain themes untouched that he's tapping into right now.
Yeah, I think that as well. But I do think we can talk about that. I think it already came up a little bit in our conversation, or you spoke about that already. Maybe you have something to add to that, because you've written articles about the evangelical people who voted right. for Trump.
Right, yeah, I've traveled U.S. Yeah. Last summer. Let's see. What was the question?
What did you see when you were there?
Right.
Because you said you saw it coming. So how did you come to that conclusion?
Right. Trump has had a huge boon from evangelicals by somehow managing to win their trust, telling them that he would nominate a conservative judge for the Supreme Court, which was a huge deal, and there might be two judges, which of course is, which sets the course of the Supreme Court for mm-hmm. decades. So they're right on that. The problem that Trump tapped into was the extreme unpopularity of Hillary Clinton, which he herself seemed unaware of. She didn't know. Took no effort at all to reach out to people who weren't primarily her base. Well, she did, but she could have done way more. Barack Obama, for example, he did a much better job of reaching out to evangelicals more to the center, more to the left. He won them over. And I think also a problem for Democrats at this point, or last year, was the identity politics that they kept fighting, going on and on about transgender bathrooms, giving people like evangelicals and other conservative, social conservatives the idea that all the left is concerned about is these identity politics and these rights for what they see as minority groups and like leftist hobbies, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. Which made them not, which gave them the impression that the left wasn't hearing their concerns. Right?
And I want to go to Kirsten now, because in some way you can make a comparison between Hillary Clinton maybe and the PvdA or other leftist parties right now, because some people also think those parties are out of touch with the people. How do you see that?
Well, I think first of all, the role played by sexism cannot be overstated mm-hmm. in this enough. I mean, sexism is very deeply rooted, just as racism unfortunately still is. And a lot of people, I think, underestimated the power of sexism. So when it comes to explaining Hillary's loss, I think that should be part of that conversation. Mm-hmm. And yes, a lot of women, especially white women, voted for Donald Trump. Well, women are not exempt from being sexist. So women are also raised in a sexist world, in a racist and sexist world. So that is one. The other, about being out of touch, about living in a political bubble. I also get those remarks when I'm campaigning. Mm. And at the same time, when I really talk to people, like for example, yesterday we were campaigning in The Hague with PvdA, and we were in a neighborhood that's very mixed, very diverse, and we were talking to people. And the moment you get a little deeper, people admit that actually it's not that bad, or actually they really appreciate it that you're talking to them. And actually they agree with me when I say that we should yell at each other less and listen to each mm-hmm. other more. So I feel that there is actually a deep need that's almost heartfelt that that people want politics to be more civil and
but
more.
But that's campaigning. Because then politicians go out on the streets. But how can you keep reaching those people for the upcoming 4 years?
Yeah, I think that's very important. I think it's also important to make sure that we keep fighting for the, let's say, the losers of globalization. You mentioned that the Midwest, where you're from, is still not totally recovered. And I think, we've come a long way. We in Holland actually are not doing that bad on the whole. But there are still people who are struggling to make ends meet. One out of four single moms is still on welfare in the Netherlands. Poverty actually has a female face in the U.S. as in the Netherlands. I think those are topics that especially people on the left side of the political spectrum, and as a social democrat, as member of PvdA, I of course feel that way, that we need to keep fighting for those people too. Mm. So now, fortunately, now that we got the country sort of back on track, this is the time that we can continue investing in those people. And I think we need to cooperate more. And that's another thing that a lot of people say about politics when they're negative about politics here. You're only attacking each other. And I think it's very important that progressive parties join hands and
attack Wilders.
And let's not attack, but let's just work to make the future better.
Okay. Yeah. About Geert Wilders, Sarah, you know a little bit of about Geert Wilders. Do you think he's a threat to us right now? Do you think there's a big chance that not only him but also Le Pen in France and in different countries in Europe will be on the lead for the upcoming 4 years?
Yeah, I mean, I can't prognosticate as to whether he'll win, as to, you know, the chances of his success, but it's obvious that there's a, you know, a larger movement that goes beyond Trump, beyond Wilders, that's a, you know, white nationalist movement throughout Europe and throughout the U.S., you know, that we saw in Poland and Hungary.
Yeah.
You know, and the thing that worries me is that the transformations that these sorts of politicians can cause happen very rapidly. Like, if you look at Poland 1 year ago versus it now, you know, there are things in it that are unrecognizable. And they work in tandem. You know, like, when Trump won, some of the first people he had over were, you know, Nigel Farage and Le Pen.
Yeah.
And so, you know, they work together. They do have an ideology. I think Trump's is more malleable. You know, I think he's easily influenced. But, you know, that ideology prioritizes some lives above others. You know, like, the term identity politics came up, you know, in kind of a pejorative way, but, you know, I think at heart, identity politics are about rights. And in the United States, you don't get to choose your identity. You don't get to choose your race, your gender, but your rights are often determined by those things. And especially, you know, with the appointment of Jeff Sessions, who is a notorious racist going back to, you know, the civil rights era, as our attorney general, rights will be lost on the basis of identity. So I think that will happen in Europe as well. You see that in the, you know, anti-immigrant, anti-Muslim kind of parts of platforms. And so I think if the debate is reframed as a matter of human rights, of civil rights, versus sort of identity in an abstract sense, then I think a lot more people will support it and stand up for their fellow citizens, hopefully.
But in some ways, we're looking up to especially American universities, where the discussions about race and about sexism are like so much further along the road than the way we speak about it.
I feel like a lot of that coverage is weird. You know, like the way the New York Times and stuff covers our universities, they pick the most elite kind of upper class universities. Most Americans don't go to a university, period. Or if they go, they go to a community college. And they're not spending all this time kind of talking about, you know, Foucault and about, you know, all this kind of abstract intellectual rhetoric and is gender real or is everything vegetarian? I mean, that's just not what they're doing. They're trying to get their degree. They're trying to work their jobs. You know, that's pretty much it. But I feel like that whole, you know, political correctness crisis is overstated. The real crisis for the American college student is debt and money. That's what people are thinking about a lot more.
Yeah. And Robin, because you spoke about identity politics as well.
Let me first say, because you remarked that I was using it in a pejorative way. I'm not against it.
No,
course.
No.
it's a lofty course, but I don't think it was that smart. it could have been used in a smarter way during the election.
What should they do then? Or what should leftist parties here do? What kind of story do they have to tell?
I was about to say they should be clamoring for respect for institutions, respect for civil society, respect for the media, something that Geert Wilders absolutely doesn't have, and he showed it again today, right? For those who don't know, not going to the RTL debate because
big television debate.
Yeah,
because
RTL,
because they interviewed his father.
His brother. And he was mad, and then he said, "I'm not coming anymore." Well, that's not normal, and that should be called for what it is. Unfortunately, Dutch parties have been doing that. Alexander Pechtold, but also other people from other parties. Mm. And it doesn't really seem to ring true to lots of voters. If I go to talk to a PVV supporter and I say, well, the media is important and the norms that we have in politics are important and the system that we have is important, he's like, yeah, but I have my problems and Geert Wilders is going to solve them. So fuck that, right? Yeah. And so the problem is, how do you explain, and how do you, I think the problem is, how do you show people, I think explaining is the way, but how do you show people that these things that are so abstract, that they are important?
Mm-hmm. And do you have an answer to that?
No.
No. Does anybody have an answer to that right now? Yeah, maybe, yeah. Bertina?
Well, I'm not sure. I always wonder whether the PVV voters really care about those debates. And I also wondered, there was a very nice, some very nice interviews in Volkskrant, I think, this weekend with PVV voters. And
educated the PVV voters, yeah.
But the thing is, I think this is the same thing with Trump voters. They not only vote for Trump or Wilders because they think Trump and Wilders have the solutions, but they also just want to send a signal to conventional parties. You need to stop and listen to us and listen to the worries we have, and you have to do something about it. And lots of those voters actually say, I don't even want him to be in a cabinet. I just want the other parties to adopt his points of view.
I think that's exactly part of the problem, because by doing so, you're normalizing a part of an extreme right rhetoric.
And
part of the people
further,
who were in those interviews said that they wanted less migrants. Now, I don't want progressive parties to take on that rhetoric. Unfortunately, most progressive parties in the Netherlands don't. But still, it is a slippery slope. And the normalization of extreme right rhetoric is what I fear most. And it's not just on migration. It's also, for example, about climate change. I mean, just look at the, what's his name again? The appointee for
Jeff Sessions?
No. The other guy who's a climate, he denies, yeah. Yeah, he denies climate change, and he's now heading the Environmental Protection Agency. That is scary.
But I think it's also quite a danger thing to, like, call the PVV voters or make them some kind of cattle. I think,
true,
in some way, loads of the PVV voters know exactly what they're voting for. And they're not like in the slippery slope, and I don't know anymore if it's right to put immigrants out of the country. They do know. They know exactly.
I think it's also bringing to the surface part of our countries, like the United States, like France, like the Netherlands, that a lot of people hoped was not there.
Yeah.
And I think you have to kind of separate, you know, legitimate, proven grievances from the scapegoating that all of these politicians engage in and encourage citizens to engage in. Like, I first became worried about Trump when he came to the Midwest and he began talking about how he had a 40% unemployment rate. And technically, this is not true. Technically, our unemployment rate is actually about 5%. But It feels like it's 40% because so many people are underemployed, so many people are making very low wages and can't pay their bills. And so when he said that, it was the kind of lie that is a lie, but it felt true. And it felt true to me, you know, and I can't stand the guy. But, you know, and I was thinking, my God, if he's having this kind of emotional reaction on me, and I know better because I follow him closely, what is a regular person who's been down on their luck for a very long time going to think? And then the problem is, though, that Trump doesn't ever explain the actual reason you know, for this economy, things like corporate greed or automation. Instead, he blames it on Mexicans. He blames it on immigrants, and people buy into that. And so, you know, one thing that I'm worried about in the future, whether he is in government or out, is that the scapegoating will continue, that these hate crimes that have already begun to rise will continue to rise, because I don't think anyone's economic fortune is going to improve under the Trump administration. I think things are actually going to get worse, and they're going to look for a target for that frustration, and it won't necessarily be the government.
Yeah. Okay. Maybe we should go to the audience right now, and we can also discuss some further. Oh, you were going to do it? Great. So is there anybody in the audience who has a question? I can imagine maybe loads of you. Just raise your hand. Maybe we can have a little bit of light in the...
So hostile.
Okay. Hi, Sarah. You started out your keynote speech by saying the Constitution is just a piece of paper and checks and balances maybe to some degree go out the window. But haven't we seen in the past month, actually, with the travel ban, that Trump can be checked and that, you know, Trump, he can do anything that he wants. So basically my question is, even though he can do damage, shouldn't we and you have more faith in the U.S. system and the U.S. Constitution that he can't knock down the pillars of democracy?
Well, the reason I tend to not have faith in it is because I've seen this happen in other countries that also have a democratic constitution. Like, there are dictatorships all over the world that have this. And, you know, Trump has chosen his cabinet with the explicit purpose of dismantling democratic norms and dismantling democratic laws. And there's definitely pushback. And I think you see this pushback most thoroughly with the judiciary, you know, who have been working to strike down these executive orders. But, you know, he is going to pick a Supreme Court justice. He is going to appoint a lot of judges. He's going to put people in power who have the potential to rewrite our laws so that they deny people their rights. And, you know, this might take a while for them to pull off. I'm sure it'll be resisted also by many, but it's possible. So I don't necessarily think we're doomed to some kind of autocratic system, but I think we really need to be active and to push back, honestly, in the way people have been doing for the last month. I think that there's been unexpected resistance that's proven effective, but it needs to be consistent all the way through, and then we might get through this semi-scathed.
Yeah, I have an up-following question. Do you think he already has like a long-term strategy for that, or is his strategy chaos and destruction?
I think there are different people in the administration, some of whom have a very long-term strategy, and some of whom are erratic and temperamental or are just manipulating the office. I think, you know, Trump's strategy, his character is actually consistent over the last 40 years. His strategy is often just reacting to whatever happened that day and whatever mood he's in. I think Bannon has a strategy that's very radical and destructive, and the strategy itself is a kind of chaos that he's hoping to capitalize on. I think there are people like Jeff Sessions in the more extreme parts of the Republican Party who are basically, you know, bringing, you know, civil rights era racist policies back into fashion 50 years after they were struck down. And you can think in a way that is a very long-term plan, that if somebody like that has remained, you know, within our government for so long, but now, late in life, is elevated to this position of power without changing his views, without learning anything from his experiences. And so it really depends on the individual, you know, in terms of strategy.
Hello. I have two questions. One is, I saw that the petition for the impeachment of Trump is already put in place, or the request is already made. And my question was, how fast will this get effect? And the second question is, in Holland we have an electoral system when there is some kind of crisis, then we get new elections. And there's also, does also have the American system such a mechanism?
No. I'm very jealous that you have such a mechanism. I'd be very surprised if we have new elections, but again, we are in an unprecedented situation, especially with Trump's relationship to Russia, you know, which is part of a congressional investigation recently resulted in, you know, the resignation slash termination of Michael Flynn, you know, who was improperly engaged with Russia. There's the chance that that connection and its, you know, financial and political ramifications may result in Trump leaving office. It's just very hard for me to imagine Trump accepting this. Like, if someone tells him he's impeached, I have a feeling he won't go. So I don't know exactly how that would work. I can't picture him, you know, resigning, knowing impeachment is around the corner. I mean, I sort of see him being obstinate and saying, no, I'm still the president. No, I'm staying. And I think it's going to be very disastrous. And it also relies on the GOP, on the Republicans, to do the impeachment because they are controlling the government. They seem to have no desire to get him out, even though, you know, I know on an individual level, many of them are concerned about the direction our country is going. I think they want to see how far they can take it. Like, what can they get out of this? What policies can they get passed? And then maybe after that, they'll want to get, you know, the lunatic out of the White House. But, you know, it may take some time. I think that might be part of their strategy.
But even if Trump gets impeached, it will be Pence, right? Or is there some way in the system to get rid of him altogether?
No, it would be Pence unless Pence is proven to have also been implicated in something. Like with Michael Flynn, you know, that's a question, is how much Pence knew. And so it's possible that some of the others in the administration may be taken out because they were part of this, especially if they were there during the campaign season, which is when a lot of these deals
right.
occurred. And Pence was around. It's very hard for me to think that Mike Pence did not know what was going on. I mean, in part because it was written about in like the Financial Times, and you just had to kind of read that, you know, wasn't exactly a secret. So yeah, I'd be surprised if he wasn't implicated, but they may just allow him to stay anyway. I think people are very afraid of the chaos of the situation, and that can't be underestimated, that people don't want a radical change in government. But then again, we're getting that with Trump. So.
Yep.
Next question.
I wanted to ask about the last one thing that Sarah said about this emotional connection that Trump makes, you know, with his voters. You know, like, people watch him, some people watch him, they feel him, and they feel like he's their guy, you know, even though he's not objectively, but he makes them feel that way. So what I was wondering, why is it always like the bad guys who are able to make this connection with the average voter, and why can't we have like a good person, you know, like, who stands up for constitutional rights and, you know, all the good things, and connects with, you know, all the voters, like a large contingent of voters?
Yeah, I mean, that's a good question. I would say, you know, we do have that. You know, whatever you think of Obama's last 8 years, I think the 2008 campaign, you know, was an example of that, of a politician kind of coming out of nowhere, making a very deep emotional connection with voters that resulted in record turnout of voters. You know, the emotional connection Trump makes is based on the exploitation of pain. If America were not in bad shape, I think if people weren't hurting, if people weren't already frightened and, you know, feeling victimized before he came around, I don't think he could have won. I don't think he could have won in a good economy. I don't think he could have won without the wars that America has been engaged in. And so that's been his whole life. You know, when an industry collapses, you know, real estate, media, entertainment, Trump comes and swoops in and exploits that pain. He had a reality show during a recession in which the tagline was, "You're fired," and people loved him for it. That's his special talent, and it's a very unfortunate one, and he used it very well during the election. I think it may be different as a president. When this guy is your president, you want him advocating for you. You don't want him saying "you're fired" gleefully and laughing in your face. And so I think he's having trouble transitioning into that kind of leader instead of a campaigner.
Can we blame Obama for Trump?
I mean, you can blame everyone for Trump. You know, it takes a village, as Hillary Clinton said, to make Trump. I think there are mistakes that Obama made. You know, I think he had some foreign policy issues. You know, I think Obama was also handed the most difficult conditions in my lifetime that I've ever seen any president handed. You know, he came in right when the recession began. He had to take care of George Bush's foreign policy missteps, which were enormous. He had to end two wars. He had a very
defiant Republican Congress that was also full of racists that were trying to hold him back. You know, that said, I do think he made mistakes. He could have done more here or there, but you can't kind of distance that from the enormous amount of baggage he inherited. And I think most of the criticism of him is, you know, far too vehement, often very conspiratorial, you know, too strong. One thing I wish he had done is investigate, you know, Trump and the FBI's investigation, like be more active in that during the campaign season, because unfortunately we're dealing with the ramifications with him in power, and he of course doesn't want to investigate himself. So I wonder whether it'll ever really be investigated. So I wish under Obama, I wish that had taken place.
Okay, next.
Hi, I have a question. There's something that's I've been wondering when I hear about it or read about it. It ties in with the bigger question of what we just spoke about, what really motivates BVV or Trump voters. Is it really their very personal situation, or how knowledgeable are they really when they vote? And in this regard, I've wondered why I hear people say that, for example, the coal workers who are all out of jobs now, but at least they have some sort of relief or allowance to take care of their lungs. They go to doctors and they get medicines that they can afford, which is like literally a lifesaver for them. And I've heard many of them say that they didn't realize that was Obamacare. Mm-hmm. And when I see that, I wonder, like, who did you think put that in place? Who was your president for the past 8 years? Maybe you do understand, or maybe Robin has heard people talk about that in the summer, but how does that work?
Yeah, I mean, one thing first, you know, it's interesting you brought up the coal workers, because that's been such a key component of his campaign. I don't know if you know this, but one of the people, you know, along with miners, who was in Trump's ad as a miner was Dutch. He got a Dutch model to dress up as a miner, so that's Trump's actual connection to those groups of those people from those industries. And, you know, in terms of your second question about what did they think, how did they not know the Affordable Care Act was Obamacare, you know, that is the product of 8 years of right-wing media, I think of social media creating filter bubbles in which people get, you know, only certain types of information. This has been a wake-up call for a lot of Americans. It's been a wake-up call for the Republican Party that their constituents actually don't want to lose their health insurance and be without health insurance in case of injury. And so, yeah, but, you know, we've had a very effective propaganda machine. And I think if people are, you know, segregated in their communities, if they're segregated in their media tastes, then they're going to get a certain narrative. And it takes actual ramifications, like, say, losing your health care to challenge that narrative, unfortunately.
Can I maybe add to that? Because I think you just pointed to something that's so crucial about us living in bubbles. And I think a lot of people in this country as well live in bubbles, in neighborhoods, in schools, in jobs, and us here. Yeah, us here. I doubt whether there are people here in this audience who vote PVV or Trump. No, you're shaking your head. Probably not, right? So the bubble piercing is, I think, it's so important to think about that. How do we do that? And part of it is create mixed schools, and create, for example, if you don't have a mixed school, create experiences for children to actually get out of their bubble and interact. If that's with, you know, with coachy buddy programs, there's wonderful examples of what you can do to actually, because people need to keep talking to each other. We cannot just you know, we just can't.
Yeah. Oh, sorry, yeah. Oh, there. Yeah.
Okay. My question is for Sarah as a freelance journalist. I'm a freelance journalist as well, and I'm expecting there's a few of us in the room. I respect your work so much. I'm wondering if you can tell me, as someone who studies authoritarianism, how much that has influenced how you work as a freelancer right now, and if you can give any advice for those of us in the room, not just how to protect ourselves as freelancers, but also like how we can contribute the best right now, what you think we should be doing.
Yeah, I mean, freelancing, thank you for your comments, by the way, I appreciate that. You know, freelancing is a mixed bag because we have, you know, less financial and professional stability, but I do think we have more creative freedom. And, you know, being the pessimist that I am, I kind of placed my bets early last year and began, you know, freelancing for a lot of different outlets in case some of them went under and in case some of them weren't allowed to print, you know, my ideas or my work. You know, and I did it in different countries. And a lot of that is just,
kind of luck, you know, who was willing to work with me, who I wanted to work with. You know, again, I obviously prioritize my ability to survive financially, but that money other than survival isn't that important to me. I think that, you know, if we're lucky enough to work in writing and in journalism for a living, you know, we have an obligation and a responsibility beyond that. You know, which is to serve the public. I think to look at, you know, who is suffering in society, who is going to be impacted by policies, to talk to them directly, as you were saying, to, you know, get out of bubbles and not in some sort of parachute journalism kind of way. I mean, one thing I wish we were seeing more of were people who actually live in areas that are underrepresented in media, live there around the clock, writing more for national publications, you know, getting those stories out not from the perspective of a visitor, but from a resident. So if, you know, you're from some place that's underrepresented and you feel like you got to move to the big city or whatever to work, I think there are ways around that. And I think that it's, you know, the more diverse perspectives we have, you know, rural or urban, and, you know, people from all different backgrounds and education levels, I think the healthier we'll be as a society, because people will feel represented, people will feel listened to, different concerns will get on the table. Anyway, that was a long-winded answer. but you know, good luck to you, and I guess just, you know, follow your conscience, you know, follow your heart, and, you know, hope you land on your feet.
Next question.
Yes, Ms. Kendzior, your research in Central Asia, you have...
Could you please, we can't see your face, or maybe, just, yeah, light, thanks, yeah.
Yes, you have researched autocrats in Central Asia, and in the light of Mr. Trump's cognitive deterioration, what do these people do when they come to face with their own mortality? If they have any self-awareness at all, will he just burn the planet to the ground? What will he do?
Yeah, that's a good question. I mean, this has been an interesting year for me because the president of Uzbekistan died. And it took about 4 days for this death to actually become official. He died 4 days before it made the news. And during that time, the Uzbek opposition was making all these cartoons of, you know, President Islam Karimov dead, and then all of his advisors being like, you know, who's going to tell him? Who's going to break the news that he's dead? I'm too scared. And so, you know, there is this attitude of, you know, intense fear of autocrats, including by, you know, fellow workers in the government, to defy them in any way. You know, as for Trump's cognitive state, you know, there's a lot of speculation on that. There's been a lot of mental health professionals that have said that, you know, something is truly awry, that he may have dementia, that he has narcissistic personality disorder, you know, and then others saying, no, actually, he's just cruel and terrible, and you don't need a psychological diagnosis in order to, you know, destroy a nation. I don't know whether, as he declines mentally, if that is to be the path that we're on, whether anyone will do something. You know, again, this is unprecedented. It's certainly not a person you want with the capacity to launch wars. So yeah, I don't know, because, you know, all autocrats do tend to surround themselves with lackeys and yes men. Trump's struggling to do that in the United States and having a bit more of a problem than countries like Uzbekistan, which have always had a system like that, have done. So perhaps there will be, you know, some pushback ultimately if he gets too out of control. But then again, that's the kind of thing that people hoped would happen for the last 16 months, that there would be enough pushback that he'd finally just get taken out of the picture somehow. And he's the president, so we'll see.
Over there?
Yeah, Remco Zuidema. I have questions going to the next election, the midterms. Normally, the midterms is completely Republican dominated. Do you think that this situation will make this a different midterm as is usual, combined with the Sanders team, our revolution, trying to take over the Democrat Party from inside as a mobilization ground for this midterm?
Yeah, I mean, I'll be pretty excited if we have midterms, because that would mean we still have a country that has elections that aren't decided in advance. So, you know, my expectations got really low. Yeah, I think it'll be very interesting midterms, should they occur. You know, as I was saying before, there are a lot of new voices in politics. I'm seeing people announce that they're going to run for Congress that don't have political experience. You know, many of them are young, many of them are women. you know, people who aren't traditionally represented well in our government, and they feel like I need to do it. You know, I need to rise up, because otherwise, you know, there's not going to be an opposition to this administration. And so if these kind of unconventional candidates make some waves, that could be interesting. You know, the Democratic Party is a mess right now. You know, the primaries were very divisive. You know, there's a huge gap that I hoped a rising autocrat would kind of bring people together for the greater good. That hasn't entirely happened. I don't know what kind of candidate, you know, will arise, but, you know, I think that right now we're in a period, it's unbelievably, it's only been 1 month. As people's rights are stripped away, unfortunately, that may bring about that unity that is necessary, not just within Democrats, but among people who aren't in any party. And I should stress that that's 43% of Americans are independent voters, non-affiliated, because of the frustration with the two-party system, with both parties. And those voters, I think, may become more active, maybe joining the Democratic Party, or at least more engaged. Yeah, I think, you know, Americans have long taken their rights and their liberties for granted. You know, not all Americans did, but many of them did. I think those days are gone. I think everyone is realizing how fragile we are as a country, and that may encourage, you know, more vociferous opposition and people participating in the midterms.
Okay, we're going to take two more questions, and then we'll go to the bar.
Okay. Is humor and satire going to help us in these difficult days? I enjoy watching Saturday Night Live, Bill Maher, Joe Pacton, and other things. I know that probably Trump supporters won't watch those programs, but it gives me a lot of energy and also insights, I must say. What do you feel about
alternative channels? You know, humor is essential. You know, like even just before, I was bringing up jokes made by the Uzbek opposition, and you know, that's a grim country. Like, if you're making jokes in that environment, that's I think a sign of, you know, your determination. And also, jokes are a way that in satire and humor, they bring people together. They have, you know, communities coalesce around these things. They kind of take the autocrat down a notch or two. They drive Trump crazy. You know, like a large number of his tweets since he's been elected have been about the entertainment industry versus issues of world policy, because he can't handle that. You know, and sometimes I worry a little that he'll be pushed too far by, you know, impersonator on Saturday Night Live, which is, again, not something you want to be worrying about in terms of your president, but that's where we are.
But are you thinking about blacklists then for like
a McCarthy? Kind of, I think that that's possible. I mean, an interesting thing that's happening in America now is that, you know, the Republicans are the party of big business traditionally, but you're seeing corporate pushback against this administration, like during the Super Bowl or a big football game. The ads were basically anti-Trump. They were, you know, pro-immigration, pro-tolerance, pro-diversity, and Hollywood is one of our biggest industries. Hollywood helped create Trump, unfortunately, but I think they have some regrets. And I think that they may be, you know, quite a force against him, and I'm not sure that the government will be able to control, you know, what Hollywood does, because the public wants their entertainment. You take away our Netflix, like, then you might see a revolution in America. Other things, I don't know, but, you know, they will fight to keep their entertainment programs.
Okay, last question. Okay, cool. No, wait 1 second, but because I have one question as well. How did Hollywood do that then? How did they make Trump? Because I consider Hollywood always to be a little bit leftist.
They helped, you know, our news industry, unfortunately, has bled into our entertainment industry around the time of the O.J. Simpson trial, never quite came back. And, you know, Trump was viewed as entertainment. He hosted Saturday Night Live before they became an enemy of the state, like me. You know, and he was part of that. He was on talk shows. He was doing little bits and movies. You know, you can go through like 30 years of American entertainment, and there's Donald Trump, you know, in some B-grade made-for-TV schlock thing. And so, you know, they helped him out. But I do think that, you know, they will fight back now. I've seen a lot of entertainers, you know, on Twitter being very vocal about this. So I have faith in Hollywood. Who would have thought?
Okay, last question.
Hi, Sarah. I'm Neftin from Groningen. It's a Dutch city up in the north of Holland. Can I take it? Oh, sorry. So I just wanted to tell you two things and ask you also a question. I'm following you for quite some while now on Twitter, and you always scare me. But I've come to a point when it's actually not scary anymore, but it's also giving me a sense of calm because I have a sense of what's going on, and it's actually helping me gaining focus and calmness because I have a sense of what's going to happen. So that also gives me a sense of knowing what to do. So thank you. Also, I wanted to tell you that I started some little protesting action group in Groningen, and the response to that has been quite overwhelming for me, and that's also partly because of you. So again, thank you for that. The question I want to ask is, what is fascinating me is the I was always taught that Americans are very patriotic. So I was a little bit surprised that the outrage for the Russian hacks, for example, didn't seem so big as I would expect it. What I also seeing is, like Geert Wilders, for example, being very nationalist, but tweeting in English. I see Le Pen saying we should skip double passports, except for Russia. And the narrative is always these people are very nationalist, but as they work together so much, is this, I'm just wondering, is this nationalism, or is this loyalty to your nation, or loyalty to your skin color? Or so my question is, how do you think about this, and how do Trump voters you talked about think about this?
Yeah, the Russia issue is a really strange one. I mean, I have to say, you know, I study the former Soviet Union, so I know more about Russia than the average person. If I had heard all the things that I've heard said about Russia, about a country that I knew nothing about, I might think it was improbable. I might think it's wild, conspiratorial, you know, what have you. But I have studied, you know, Russia and Putin. I know how he operates. I've studied regimes that are very similar as well. And so, you know, I find, you know, the things they're looking for in the congressional investigation completely plausible. I also can see how other Americans might not, because it's so crazy. I mean, it's like being in a spy movie, only it's your own government. And this is on top of all of, you know, the many ridiculous things we've discussed this evening. So I think it's just kind of a lot for people to process for, like, the average voter. That's a little different than the party. The Republican Party has done, like, a 180 on Russia. Back in 2014, they were upset about, you know, the invasion of Crimea, about, you know, authoritarian tactics. You know, you definitely saw even this year with Rex Tillerson, who was given the Order of Friendship by Putin, becoming our Secretary of State, some pushback from Republicans, noting all of their human rights violations. So, but they, you know, on the whole, seem willing to overlook it. And there is an element of race involved. You know, white supremacists have been going to Russia for training. There's connections philosophically between some ideologues in Russia that put forth this white supremacist narrative and people in the U.S. Russia's also backing a number of state secessionist movements, you know, the Cal exit, California exit movement. You know, one of their leaders gets flown to Moscow for training. And, you know, I think they want the United States to fall apart, even if it ultimately doesn't benefit them per se. I think that this is kind of revenge for the Cold War. I mean, Putin was, you know, active in the KGB at that time, and I think when Russia is hurting domestically, you know, as it is under Putin, it's a great distraction to have this foreign policy where you're watching America fall apart. That's something that Putin can sell to Russian citizens, you know, as a distraction from their own problems. So anyway, a lot of complicated stuff going on. But yeah, I think, you know, at heart we are a patriotic country. I think we're also a country that's very confused about what's going on with this investigation, in part because of how it's been reported, in part because it's an intelligence thing, so not all the details can be revealed, which also makes people suspicious. They're like, oh, well, you know, if it was serious, they would tell us everything, and then they're like, because it's serious, we can't tell you anything. And so, you know, you're just hearing all these different variations, and so I get why people are confused, but I do think it is serious, possibly with, you know, repercussions, including impeachment. So, you know, as complex as it is, it's worth catching up on.
Okay, so I saw one very urgent question.
Yeah.
No, the other questions can be asked at the bar, maybe if you'll be there for a few minutes.
Yeah, this one, thank you first for all your work, Sarah. I follow you on Twitter. And I was wondering, what is your vision on the role that is the fake news is playing in the elections here in Europe, but also in the United States? And also, I've been reading about Cambridge Analytica, and it's from the Mercer family, but Steve Bannon is on the board. And I heard they were profiling on Facebook, and people that maybe were a little bit on the Democratic side, they were being influenced. And then they thought Clinton was like a member of the pedophile network. And I started to vote for Trump. And then they did a research on the New York Times, and they said there was no influence of the fake news, but I don't believe it. So what is your vision on the role that Cambridge Analytica and fake news is playing, and also in Europe?
Thank you. That's a tough question. I've gone to I've given, I think, four different talks on the, quote, fake news issue. I mean, first of all, that phrase has been weaponized by Trump. That's like Trump's, Lügenpresse. Like, it's his new favorite thing in order to castigate the media and strip them of legitimacy. So anything that's not flattering is fake news, and everything that says he's wonderful is the truth. There is a number of factors to, like, what is fake news. There's the disinformation. There's concerted propaganda efforts, that were in part backed by foreign actors like Russia. There's sloppy reporting, which sometimes just gets labeled as fake news, but I think is different because of intent. And so, that's why I don't like the term, because it tends to sweep all these very different phenomena under one rubric that then is politically advantageous for Trump. I'm less concerned with the fake news aspect than I am with things like Cambridge Analytica and our rights to our privacy online, and how, the fact that almost all of us have left a very long trail of our, daily lives, of our personal thoughts, of our networks and connections all over the internet, unaware that there would be a sweeping tide of white nationalist autocrats ready to come into power and use this information to their advantage, that's a huge concern. That was another area when someone brought up Obama. Obama's cybersecurity policies weren't good. I think it was very hard for politicians to play catch up with a very rapidly changing technology that in turn caused a lot of rapid social changes. And so for somebody like Cambridge Analytica, if you don't know this, this is a information mining company that allegedly has, profiles on every American consisting of, I think, like 5,000 parts of data, that has Steve Bannon, Trump's advisor, on the board, therefore giving the state, in a formal way, the ability to abuse this information to potentially harm American citizens. That's a huge concern. That's the kind of power that needs to be checked. And instead, we have that power possibly going to be mobilized in an executive capacity. And so that's one of the things I am actually most worried about going forward.
Okay. Well, I think we're going to wrap it up for now. We can maybe have a drink at the bar. Everybody just maybe to drink our sorrows away a little bit. Okay, I'd like to thank our panel, Kirsten, Bertine and Robin. I'd like to thank the Balie for having us, the correspondents for also having some assistance in making this program. And I'd really like to thank Sarah Kendzior for coming here, for your...
Thank all of you.
Yeah, the great things you've said, and thank you very much.
Thank you.